I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left.
This is Paul Cheon, also known as Haumph.
Join us on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific for Magic TV, where we answer the burning questions posed to us by you, the audience, like Chipotle or La Vic, or where do these guys get their hair done?
And also every single week, we're going to be having a special guest from Channel Fireball, like Louis Scott Vargas, Josh Arleighton, Tom Martell, and many others.
With all that and Dark Steel Humphrey, we'll see you next Wednesday.
Hello and welcome to a Channel Fireball draft video. My name is Greg Hatch, and I'll be doing a Dragons of Tarkir Fate Reforged draft. So these are a little bit wonky. It's funny, it was just Cons of Tarkir, and then it was Fate Reforged, and then now it's a new set with one of the old sets. So definitely a departure from the past as far as how drafts are done. But pretty exciting overall. I like that this set is very conducive to monocolor strategies. There's not a lot of land picking. There's only one set with a bunch of dual lands. And you can go multiple colors and get rewarded for it. But typically, it's really possible to go mostly one color and then splash one. And whether or not that's right or wrong, that's something I've had a lot of success with. So it's something I'm going to try to do. So let's see. This is definitely a another take on a... they used to make these symmetricals, but that's a hell of a card. It's not for defense, but it's something I got to consider. I don't like going red so early. A lot needs to go right for a red deck to come together. There's a lot of moving parts, aggressive, defensive. So I try to avoid it. I like white and green specifically as far as the starting color goes. They're very strong. Black as well has some upside, but not enough to get me excited. Defeat is typically pretty good, especially with a lot of morphs. So I would say here, defeat is definitely the most versatile of all these options and the one that's going to get me the most range in the draft. I can basically go a lot of different ways. I can splash it. I can play base black. But most of all, I can react to early creatures, which gives me a lot of flexibility in deck building and in the early game in general. 2/1 death touch. In general, I like one mana death touch creatures like the Typhoid Rats and the Ruthless Ripper. Those were really like underrated. There was like a warrior version of a death touch guy and Heart of Hateblade, I think. And they're all very good in a set where you are blocking morphs and they can't unmorph to stay alive. But so it's something to consider. I think death touch is a really valuable feature in this set specifically. There's a hexproof morph dragon, which I like a lot. I like it more than the lifelink version, but they're both, you know, not black, and I might still play it, but it's not something I want to have to do just yet. I think that I will end up taking the I'm gonna take the 2/1 as part of the curve. There's plenty of time to get these expensive morph creatures later. And staying in one color allows me to be open for other picks down the road. And again, I like to play monocolor whenever possible, or mono splasher color. And those dragons, while good, they're not good. They're not good enough to try to play a second color just yet. I do not know how I feel about these guys yet. The Slumgar Monument. If I end up going blue black, it's like a late game 4/4 flyer, kind of like the old totems from Time Spiral. If you remember those. Hard to evaluate. I don't like the mana aspect of it, and I don't like the creature aspect of it. And together, I'm not sure if they overcome the other's disability. Also, I mean, I know I'm not mentioning the only card in the pack that matters is the Defeat, which is just sitting right in front of my face. Defeat, in general, is just a very good card. So being able to have answers for threats early, and it lets you do whatever you want with the rest of your deck. You can build it to be really control-ish, really aggressive. Both strategies work really well with cheap removal. I like one mana combat tricks in sets that have morphs. So this set, as well as Cons and Fate Reforged, both have morphs as the primary feature. So having a one mana trick allows you to do something like turn two, you know, two drop, turn three, morph, turn three, attack, play a one mana combat trick, and then play a morph. And if you're on the play, that means you have three creatures to their zero if they try to block on turn three with their morph. Something very interesting to consider. I don't want to take this. I don't want to splash this, really. I don't want to take this 1/4 flying either because it's black. I don't like any of these cards necessarily, but I like the one mana pump spell for the reasons I mentioned before. Twin Bolt is something that I wouldn't blame you for taking. That card's very, very good. I just don't want to take another color just yet. And that's the first time. So, well, again, not the first time, but like that's something that I think reasonable people could disagree on, but that's the direction I'm going. Minister of Pain is very good. It's a good way to deal with a onslaught of tokens. There's like a double strike flyer. It's a 1/1. There's like a dragon fodder. There's other fast curves that involve these 2/1s. They're all like Megamorph guys, but if you cast them early. Anyway, the card's just good. Plus, 2/3s for 3 mana allow you to kind of set the score, set the pace of the game. It allows you to play it, and then, you know, you can interact with morphs. They have to flip first. There's just a lot that is better for you that way. Reckless Imp is the card I'll take here. None of these cards are particularly interesting, and none of them make me want to go a second color, so staying black allows me to stay as open as possible for later. And it's just a good card. I'll definitely play it. This card is very interesting in general. It lets you get back in the game. However, it's not actually all that great when the cards you get back aren't really notable. If they're not really good cards, then all you've done is improve the random cards in your deck by, instead of drawing the random cards, now you can draw, you know, non-lands for that length of time. In the end, I don't like that it's a 3-mana cycler if I don't need to use the ability. Okay, so knowing that, I think taking the morph here is the right play. If I'm going for money, I would take Anticipate because it's gas, but I like the morph. Doing 1 damage is pretty relevant. There's a lot of creatures that can kill. You can pick off like a lot of these like 1/1 flyers or early creatures with it. And it's easier to splash because basically I don't have to have the mana to be able to play it face down. And if I don't get to play it, if I don't get to flip it, it's not the end of the world. 2/5, I do like cards with large toughness in some sets. I don't think this is the set, but like Khans of Tarkir was a good set for high toughness creatures like that. I like this draw 3, discard 2. I think it makes sense with double defeat to have a source of card advantage in the event that I do go black-blue. I'm not married to red at all, for sure. So going blue-black makes a lot of sense if I can get the removal together. So I like where I'm at there. Contradict is certainly something very interesting. I'm not sure that I like taking it this highly, but, you know, who knows. Target you control does damage equal to its power to target you don't control. That's like fighting without fighting. I think it's pretty good with, so I'm going to take it. I mean, I'm not going to take Contradict. It's a 5-minute counter. It's just not something I imagine I'm playing. And there's some chance I play this. It's good with, like, the 5-1 I have. And it's good with the Death Touch guy. Not really all that impressed with the card. 3-mana 3/2 that makes my spells cost less when I attack is pretty much where I want to be. It's red, which is, like, where I think I'm going with the second color at the moment. And I'm not really all that mad if I end up wanting to play Contradict and I don't have it. It won't be the end of the world. I'm going to take here the... let's see. I think I take the removal spell, the turn into a 0/2, but I probably won't play it. I actually really like Spider Silk Net. So in this set, not only are there like an abundance of flyers, more than usual, I would say, having a cheap spell like that allows you to turn on certain cards that you couldn't turn on otherwise. So one of those cards is the one that's like bounce a non-land permanent. It's like a 3/4. And it's a good stabilization tool. And with a set that's full of morphs, it's something that you don't want to discount. I don't like main decking it. I don't think it's a great card. But I think it's often overlooked as an option. So, you know, some decks just need a card like Spider Silk Net. And having one allows you to be able to board into a very powerful card in certain circumstances. Looking at my deck now, there's a lot of me wishes I would have taken Twin Bolt. I think I took Code of Venom over it, and in retrospect, that's definitely looking pretty bad right now. However, it's not too far off of where I want to be. I have a lot of removal already. And anyway, so Twin Bolt number 2 I can definitely take, or number 1 in this case. Solemgar's Scorn is worth about $2. Just wanted to let you know that I care about you guys enough not to take it for the money. Vulture's Aven is a card I'm going to definitely take. So It's basically Bitter Revelation without the upside of being able to choose between four cards, but with the upside of being able to have a 2/3 flyer and sack something meaningless, or you know, you just have a lot of choice involved with that card. I don't really like Twin Bolt when I have two defeat already, more than I like this creature that gives card advantage, but it's pretty close. So I will end up taking Twin Bolt over it, but I don't know if it's right. I just know that I'm not sure enough to, like, Twin Bolt's the more obviously correct pick. Let's put it that way. if it's wrong, I don't want to be right. Sorry, no. If it's right to take Twin Bolt, I don't want to be wrong. That's what I wanted to say. This card is fantastic. This card's just outrageous. So if you have a small creature, which we don't really have yet, but I think I can kind of put together some kind of smaller creatures. Maybe in like the next set, Fate Reforged, I can get something like Soltai. There's like a 1/1 guy, Soltai Emissary, I think it is. Or if it dies, you get the manifest a card. So it's like a 1/1, and it dies, you get a manifest 2/2. With a card like this, an exploit to take care of, to utilize that creature, you get a lot of action all at once. If I play this guy and sack a creature that's like tapped or like a really bad creature, I get a 3/6, a 2/2, and another 2/2 for 5 mana. That's a lot like Cloud Goat Ranger. Anyway, it's insane. This card's very, very good. I would take it as early and often. The card's fantastic. Let's see. Volcanic Vision. Return target instant or sorcery card and do damage equal to that card's converted mana cost to each creature your opponents control. Wow. Okay, well, right now that'll do 2 damage. I don't really have anything more than 2. I do get the card back, which is cool, but that does seem kind of, I don't know. Doesn't seem very likely. It doesn't seem like it's something that's going to happen all the time. I do like this 2-drop, but I don't really think I should have to worry about the 2-drops like this. This 2-drop in particular is like not very good. It's like the worst you can get. I'm not trying to get the all aggressive. I do like this. I have no idea how good these cards are. I wanted to find out, and if it's wrong here, it's not that wrong. And I kind of am happy to have a finisher like that. If it's wrong, we'll find out. But I don't think it's wrong enough. I don't like Vial of Dragonfire. I think it's good in decks that need removal, like that have to succumb to playing a card like that. So I'm not really all that fond of the card. I am, however, fond of a card like this 1/6. It has a huge, huge defense for 4 mana. It's kind of like Kami of Ancient Stone or Kami of Old Stone, you know, like these big like walls, but it's nice to have a lot of removal and then also have a creature that basically can block everything it needs to, especially when I'm pairing it with Coat of Venom, Twin Bull, you know, a lot of ways to utilize the defense to keep my removal into my hand as much as possible. I don't want to use my removal until the absolute last moment. And so by having a creature like this, I can afford to wait because I'll basically have the creatures on the board handled. All right, so I have this Scream Reach Brawler. Pretty cool card. It's a 2/3 for 3 mana. That's probably the card I'm going to take. Hardened Berserker is good. I already have one of those. But what's bad about it is that it has 2 toughness, so it'll almost certainly die in combat to just about everything. Scream Reach Brawler, on the other hand, even without dash, is a 2/3 for 3 mana, which gives me a lot of staying power. I can play it, I can block with it, and I don't have to worry about it dying unless they unmorph, and even until turn 5, mostly that'll mean that it trades. Like, if anything that morphs before for turn 5 or for less than 5 mana will trade with 2 power. I believe that's still true. It was true in Cons and Fate Reforged. I believe it's true here as well. Which is a good change, of course. I think that makes the morph aspect of all this a little bit less random. None of these cards are any good. This is like a pretty cool dragon card. I might end up taking that just because it looks like a card that if I can splash it, it'd be kind of cool. There's also like taking like one of the morphs, like the Sandstorm Charger, and I could play that and maybe morph it. So far, actually, that actually doesn't seem that bad to me. I don't actually think that the dragon is all that great, and I don't think splashing it makes a lot of sense now that I think about it, because it's just like a 6-mana 4/4 flyer. Those are kind of dime a dozen these days. Alternatively, I can play this guy, which, you know what, I will play this guy. This guy gets back defeat and Twin Bolt, and if I will splash it, I have blue cards already ready to go on the splash. So if I do end up playing blue instead of red, or maybe splashing blue, I'm already like halfway there. All right, so this is the kind of card I'm looking to get. It's a morph. It's a 5-mana you know, pretty bad flyer for six mana, but the idea of morphing it and unmorphing it to a 4/4 first strike flyer is kind of cool. So I like that. I think it's better than anything else in the pack. I think it's better than Tail Slash because I don't actually have that many creatures right now. I'm overloaded with removal. So I'll take this morph that gets bigger. I just need a creature that's pretty good on its own, and here it is. Well, there's the Tarkir Monument, so maybe the splashing green, I could be convinced that that was wrong later. But so far, so good. This card's interesting. It is able to give creatures haste like a Tarkir Ifrit, which is like a lot of damage if I do it the right way. I can also like give cards like this haste if I have this morphed already. And basically it's a 4-mana 2/2 haste, which is not the absolute worst thing in the world. I do like the card though as a morph and as a early creature that I can play to exploit with. It's not the best card in the world. I'm not super thrilled about it. But it is a card that I can play. I don't really feel too excited about the second 1/6 either. There's not really much to go off in this pack, so it's pretty easy. Word of note, I like cards like this in this set for the same reason I like the Coat of Venom, the +1/+2 Death Touch, the +0/+5 Reach. It's just a 1-mana trick, so if you have two things that would trade, but you have a 1-mana spell to keep one alive, that 1-mana is such a huge tempo boost that I highly recommend playing it. Worth noting that Sidisi's Faithful is extremely powerful in that it both is a good blocker and it acts as a removal spell without actually having to be a removal spell in your deck. So by being a 1-mana spell that you can exploit, being able to block most everything for the first like 4 or 5 turns, and be the Void Snare that you don't have to play, if that makes sense. Like, you don't have to actually play a bounce spell. You can play this card that could be a bounce spell if you need to. Interesting stuff. I don't want to play around Artful Maneuver, so I'll take it. I'm not really worried about the 5/1. At this point, all these cards are pretty bad. I'll take this card just in case I get a good card in Fate Reforged, but these are all just like pretty bad cards. I'm just taking the one that's the most relevant. Yeah, I don't need any of these. Man, didn't they print a card with this exact same name? Vandalize? Does the same thing too. They print those as every time they can. So the Wandering Turtle Cell is not totally cool with. I really want to make sure I can win the game. Between Stormwing Dragon and Colgan Monument, I do have two. Oh boy. Okay, there's Salungar, the Drifting Death. So I think I have, what, Skarkin's Triumph? Yeah, so I can search for a dragon and put it in my hand, which includes this guy. Now this guy, of course, having Hexproof is a huge, it's a huge game. It's a huge, I mean, go ahead and beat it, right? And when it attacks, I can be sure that if they have a swarmish board state, like if they have a board state that's like trying to develop a bunch of creatures so they can attack past my huge 3/7 Hexproof, I can punish that if they're not all just one toughness. Card's great, and I'll definitely splash for it. Pyrotechnics is good now as it's ever been. No reason not to take that card pretty highly. There's also some part of me now that wants to see if I can cut down on red and perhaps only splash it, because I do have quite a few other red blue cards I can play that fit right into the thing. So let's see what I have here. I have Tail Slash, Brawl. Yeah, so red cards are pretty good. I don't really need this necessarily. I could see cutting this guy. I'll definitely play red. I'll just splash blue. Yeah, I'll just splash blue. We'll see how it goes. This guy I can play as a morph. That's fine. Anyway, we'll just see how it goes. Pyrotechnics is definitely the card I'll take here, though. I mean, it'll pretty much always kill two creatures. Shamanic Revelation is a card I can absolutely lose to, so I should be careful passing it, knowing that it's there. Part of me actually kind of wants to take it, so I don't have to worry about playing around it, but I don't know. Oh, I was just talking about things that I should be able to do to win. I want more substantial creatures, and this is really what I'm talking about. So having a card like this allows me to have a really powerful turn 5 or 6, where I play like a 5-drop or I unmorph something, and then after combat I play a 1-black 5/5 with my graveyard, hopefully. The idea is that it's not, you can play it as like a 4-mana 5/5 if you have the delve for it, but really I think its most powerful purpose is to like be one of the last cards you play, but you play two powerful spells in the same turn because you can make this cost 1 mana. As opposed to other delve spells where you're just trying to cast it for the cheapest possible. Okay, so I'm not playing white, and I don't really have a way to splash white necessarily, but this is another aggressive, awesome card. kind of cool that it exists there. I'm going to take the red black dual land. I don't think any of these other cards are any particular use to me, and I really want to have as much fixing as possible if I'm going to splash this Sylumgar. Temporal Trespass is a little outside my range of playability here. I can't really play that. I don't really want to play Ancestral Vengeance as well. It's just so expensive. I don't think I'll be able to avoid it. I pretty much have to play it. I think I'll just take it and board into it or something. It's just like not very good. I don't really want my creatures getting bigger. I mean, who doesn't? But I mean, like, I don't really benefit that much from it. Ancestral Vengeance, I'm not going to take number two. Hero's Blade's interesting. I have, like, one legendary guy, and it's good late game, especially with these, like, 1/6s I have. I can turn them into, like, 4/8s or whatever, but really, I should just take the Humble Defector. It's a 2-drop. I can't really, like, abuse it with Exploit. I wish I could, but oh well. Okay, so I'll take the blue-black dual land. Noxious Dragon is a very good card. I don't want to take it. Just kidding, I want to take it. Okay, never mind. Forget everything I just said. I think Noxious Dragon is great. What I'll do with Sylumgar is probably play like 4 islands, and then the rest I'll play black-red, and hopefully that'll be fine. But Noxious Dragon is just so good. I mean, if I can search for it, and I can play it, and then if they attack and it dies, I can kill one of their guys, so it's really difficult for them to like break through, because if they remove it, that means I get to remove one of their guys too. I'm pretty happy with that pick. I was really, really ready to just go right past it. Like, oh, I can't take that. I'll take the blue-black land. And even if the blue-black land is right, I'm not really shedding any tears. None of these cards are specifically all that good. I think the card that's the most relevant here is just a 3/3 for 4. It's just a good card. I can play it on curve. It blocks. It's just nothing special, but it's just a good, consistent card. I'm going to take another one for that same reason. I don't really need the 4/1 in this particular deck. Right into being, it would be interesting if I was more base blue. I suppose I can still just play it, and maybe cut more of the red cards, but I don't really think that's a good idea. I'll take the 4/1 instead, but I don't really like any of these cards. I don't like Mardu Rage Mark, Remark when I'm more likely going to be playing dragons to kill my opponent. Same story with this. None of these cards are really all that great. I just take the Tossigar's Cruelty. Rakasha's Disdain might be a good sideboard card, but it's no way that it's going to be more relevant than Tossigar's Cruelty. They're both pretty fringe options. Jeskai Runemark might be a good board card, but I don't want to stick around to find out. This only triggers when it enters the battlefield, so I'll take it. I have enough morphs that I feel like maybe I can abuse it. Maybe I should have taken it the first time around, because I forgot that the ability is not all the time. It's only when it comes into play. Like, I thought it was a larger disability. I'll take Warflare so I don't have to play around it. I'll take this 2-drop. It's a bad 2-drop, but when you need a 2-drop, you need a 2-drop, you know? So overall, I'm not like super stoked about this deck. I really wanted to take like something closer to like a mono green list. I've been having a lot of success with mono green, and that's what I would have preferred to have. But I can't be unhappy. I mean, I have Sylumgar, I have a lot of creatures that when I play them, my opponent has to kind of struggle to figure out how they're going to deal with it. So between Mystic Meditation and the Lore Master to get back cards like Pyrotechnics, I feel pretty good about the late game. Really what I'm concerned about is making sure I live through the early game. So I'll see if I can do that. Coat with Venom might not be the best option for me, and I may not need a card like this if I have these 2-drops, but we'll see. I definitely don't want to play Warflare. I definitely want to cut some of these cards here. Gore Swine I should cut. Hardened Berserker I should probably cut too. When I attack, the next spell is cost 1 less. I don't know how I feel about that card. I don't really want to be in a position where I'm the attacker early, and I'm not sure I like that it has 2 toughness, just period. So I'm going to cut it. That one could be wrong, but we'll see. I also don't like that Tail Slash is my removal. I don't have that many creatures, so it's somewhat likely that if I use Tail Slash, I will have like one creature to use it on, or I might not have a creature at all. So I'm just gonna be really cognizant of that as I go forward. And for now, I think I'll just cut it. It's expensive removal. Screeching Brawler, I like. Skargon's Triumph, I think, is appropriate to get this. Tormenting Voice is nice, so if I draw one of these blue spells I can't cast, I can get rid of it. It's kind of like an insurance policy. It's the same kind of logic that lets you justify cards like, you know, really bad blue cards in Legacy because you have Force of Will, you know? So it's not like it appropriately justifies it, but it justifies it enough that I feel like it helps the decision to play it a little bit more, if that makes sense. So I'm going to cut this. I think it's not where my deck wants to be. Coat with Venom is also a card I should probably cut, but I do like the idea that I can keep my morphs alive for very cheap, but it doesn't really work well with my exploit. So for now, I'll cut it. We'll see. I might get back in. I like playing this 2-drop. Even though it does damage when it dies, I need to have early board presence, and so I think it's worth the juice is worth the squeeze here. The Tomb Shell, I can definitely cut one. I might even cut both. Most of my creatures on turn 3 are colored. I have a Monument, I have a Morph, I have like a few other. I have like this Morph here. But that's it. So Ugin's Construct is kind of a liability. I don't know how I feel about it. It's definitely not good later in the game if I like draw it late and I just won't be able to play it. So I don't want to have it be in a position like that. So I'm going to cut it for now. Everything else looks fine here. I either have to cut this Smoldering Ifrit or Wandering Tomb Shell. I know I was just talking up the Smoldering Ifrit, but I think it's the last card to go. And if I count my lands here, and this Loremaster is just a morph that has an upside late, not the other way around. I have two drops. I kind of want one more of those, but oh well. Reckless Imp might actually... I should actually cut this. So the reason I'm cutting Reckless Imp is that typically it's a good card in like a really aggressive black deck or even like a mildly aggressive black deck, but I feel like my deck in particular is not that aggressive. It kind of has a very controlish feel to it. It's got like a 3/7 Hexproof Dragon. It's nice to be able to play it and attack for 2 every turn, but not being able to block is a pretty big pain. Although, worst case scenario, I suppose I can always exploit with it. I would rather just make sure I have a blocker that I can rely on. So in that case, I guess I can put the Smoldering Ifrit back in, but I actually kind of am, I don't know how I feel about Smoldering Ifrit anymore. And I kind of like Colgan Stormsinger to sacrifice as an exploit target and also as like a thing that gives like, for example, I can give this haste, which allows me to like attack and kill all the tokens in the first turn. You know, I don't think I can play the 1-1 either. I don't like either choice. Kind of stuck here trying to figure out what to do. Overall, I'm not like super happy with any of my options. I don't think I like Tail Slash still. I suppose I can just play the Wandering Tomb Shell again and have another additional blocker. I have so many late game cards that having that additional blocker is, I mean, having a blocker that I can rely on, like I can play it and then, all right, I can block with this for a while, is pretty attractive. I have a lot of finishers, so having that defense is good. So I think I'm going to do that. So that's 23. I could see playing 18 lands in this deck, but I already do have a Colgan Monument, a Tormented Voice, and a Mystic Meditation. So I think I'm just going to leave things as they are at 17 lands, but we'll see. I might actually cut the Mystic Meditation. In fact, yeah, I do have to. There's no way I can justify playing this. That way I can play 2 or 3 islands tops. So that's good. Okay. So red sources. I can get away with playing 7 red sources, but I'll put in 8 and see what the turn brings. For black sources, I want to have at least 7, and 8 would be nice. So I have 7 and I have 8 red sources and 7 black sources. That seems worse than having... So I should have 8 black sources, 7 red sources. And I have the Colgan Monument. So that's an additional red and black source that I don't want to count right away. But with 3 islands, I'll definitely be able to cast Lungar. 3 islands is important because I have Skargon's Triumph to search for it. So I want to be able to cast it. If I play 18 lands, I'll be able to activate Colgan Monument a little bit more often. But I'm just going to play the, yeah, this is between 18 and 16 lands, sorry, 18 and 17 lands, and I'm definitely going to play 17 here. Although, that's a decision that I find difficult to know if I made correctly. But we'll just see how it goes. So I need to add one more card, it looks like. So, what am I missing? Tail Slash, I don't like it. I don't like that they can remove my creature in response. I don't like that I have to have a creature at all to remove it. So that's kind of upsetting to me. I like Coat with Venom, as for reasons I explained prior. And with 15 creatures, I think it's good. I think instead I'll just play Gore Swine. So I know I was talking, never mind. Instead of Gore Swine, I'll take Hardened Berserker. That's perfect. Hardened Berserker actually has upside where I can cast my stuff for cheaper. If it's between Gore Swine and Hardened Berserker, I'll play Hardened Berserker. I do like Smoldering Ifrit, and I think it's important to have the 2-drop, but I have a bunch of removal, I guess, so if I really need to fill in my curve, I can just play the 2-drop removal spell. I don't really gain that much by playing a creature early. So, because of that, what am I going to do? Play 2-drop, 3-drop, and then a 1/6? Like, I'm not planning on killing him in curve. So, anyway, I'll submit, and I'll see you guys for round 1.